Writing Centre, supporting arts and culture in Limerick since 2008. Anyone who wants to read at the open mic, please let Dominic know before it begins in approximately an hour's time. And also, I'd like to draw your attention to our book table. There are books by local and guest authors, so please browse through them. And if you like, show your support by buying one. This month, guest readers are poets Jennifer Matthews and Louis Mulcahy. Louis Mulcahy, born in Wexford in 1941, is an award-winning poet who writes poetry. His work has been published in Poetry Ireland Review, The Steam Fly, The Shop, Stony Thursday, Southward, etc., and read on RTE One, Lyric Radio, and Radio the Gaeltachta. He's married to the tapestry artist Elizabeth Mulcahy. They have three children and eight grandchildren. Louis Mulcahy.
Everybody, thanks very much for that. I love attending Limerick and on the mail, and I'd like to thank Donald Taylor for his kind invitation to come together. I'll begin on page 20 if anybody has book two of the Clogher Quartet. I'm only reading from that book tonight. As we get older, we get more and more emotional about great efforts, big deeds, heroic performances, and sometimes it's a bit embarrassing. So I'll start with a short poem addressing that situation. The Wondrous Feats of Man. Leopold told me she liked crying because she liked the taste of tears. I said I too had felt that burning, not for more than 50 years, until of late I found them seeping for men's feats of resolution, somersaults of typhoid warning, all the sweat of evolution. And then I'll move to page 43. It's a sonnet about grasping and enjoying life, exploring the miracle that is. Dawn nudges with insistence, edging softly from one to welcome glow, until at last the night is all past tense, and spirits burgeon too, prepare to go. The day reveals a brand new treasure chest with its promise of further delight. As rifling through its load, you do your best to find the pleasures of a full taut kite. On what new charms will all the senses graze? What novel gladness will bring joy from high to send you soaring as on best of days to meet light phantoms warping in the sky? Cavorting there or prostrate under pain against the long black night is clear-cut gain. She came from the world of cash, trash that desecrates the space, where she had spun an orphan's top before her move to hockey sticks and care by maiden aunts. Victorian milliners whose inhibitions she had carried down the years, faithful to their modesty through chilly marrying nights, she was red-eyed now. For she had peeped into her past, heard the silence, felt the lack, the stilted touch, the waste. She saw a factory in the grounds, saw the dwellings' doors in rot, saw sash windows sagging, saw a tree she'd set at six, surviving with brittle, withered limbs, a sapling set forever in bright, expectant spring. Thank you very much.
Jennifer Matthews writes poetry and is editor of Long Story, Short Journal. Her poetry has been published in, or is forthcoming from, The Steam Fly, Dyslexia, The Pickett's Body, Burning Bush 2, Abridged, Revival, The Irish Examiner, and Cork Literary Review, and anthologized in Dhá Chlog's collection of emigrant poetry in Ireland, Landing Places, 2010. In 2015, she was selected for the Poetry Ireland Introductions series. Lucas, a chapbook of her poetry, was published by Smithereens Press in 2015. Follow her on Twitter at Jen Murray Mab. Jennifer Matthews.
Appreciated that you let me come here and read a few poems. And do you know how sometimes in the old timey variety shows they said kind of something like, he's the hardest working man in show business. It's kind of my image of Dominic, because every time I hear something about him, he's got 10 more duties that he does. He just does millions of things, so I really admire him and appreciate this chance to be here tonight. So my first couple of poems, The first poem I'll read is the first one I ever wrote that had any kind of success in that it was the first publication that I had. And the one that's going to come after that is one written recently, about 15 years later, 10, 15 years later. And they're nearly bookends that show that the poet's mind just keeps turning the same thing over and over again. You have these minute changes, but you can't let go of your favorite sort of bones that you chew on. So, this first poem is called Panda. It was inspired by a trip that I took to China to visit friends that were teaching English in the Peace Corps. And there's one word in it, qi pao, which means it's a Chinese traditional dress, the ones that come up with the high collar here. So, Panda. My girlfriends are surrounded by silks, and I am outside looking in at this library of the feminine. There are rolls of ruby and cherry blossoms, cool sapphire dragon pools and jade envy forests, manuals to be chosen from just beyond the stall of heady spices in the Duyun-covered market. I shuffle softly to hide my girth behind the butcher block table, while seamstress giggles fingertips to lips at the numbers that measure my friend's willowy western lengths. Their souvenirs, handmade qi paos, dresses with slender eastern cuts that lend an instant image of exoticness. My souvenir, fear of the tape wrapped wide around my hips, my thighs, my belly, marking the size of a true panda, Chinese slang for westerner, or the name of an animal which is black-eyed, weary, fumbling, unapproached, unapproaching. It's called The Good News. Long past final call, too late to look for what had gone missing in the pub, under abandoned scarves and broken umbrellas. So I climbed to the car, tongue numb, slurred directions home. The taxi man laughed, his numbered ID flapped on the dash. On the smudged mask of my face in the wing mirror, my eyelids were blinds on a lazy roll. As we flew, each turn upset the tide in my head as holy metals gossiped, tisked from the rear view. I counted the lights till home, every green a blessing. When we stopped, makeup and phone spilled in the search for fare, and the driver flashed me a Trojan smile, told me he had a gift, and reached into the console between us for a clutch of pamphlets that promised good news. He exchanged his beliefs for my cash and asked as I reached for the door, do you love the Lord? Thank you.